This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Captain Robert Falcon Scott CVORN, the 6th of June 1868. Many permanent memorials erected across the nation in the closing decades of the 20th century, Scott became a figure of controversy, with questions raised about his competence and character. Commentators in the 21st century have on the whole regarded Scott more positively, noting errors made by his team members, but attributing the expedition's fate primarily to misfortune. Contents 1 Early Life 11 Family 12 Early Naval Career 2 Discovery Expedition 1901-1904-3 Between Expeditions 31 Popular Hero 32 Dispute with Shackleton 33 Marriage 4 Terra Nova Expedition 1910-1912-41 Preparation 42 First Season 43 Journey to the Pole 44 Last March 5 Reputation 51 Veneration 52 Modern Reaction 6 References 7 Sources 71 Books 72 Online 8 Further Reading 9 External Links Early Life Family Scott, aged 13 Scott was born on 6 June 1868, the third child out of six, an elder son of John Edward and Hannah Nay Cummings Scott of Stoke Damerel, near Devonport. Scott's father was a brewer and magistrate. There were also naval and military traditions in the family, Scott's grandfather and four uncles all having served in the Army or Navy. John Scott's prosperity came from the ownership of a small Plymouth brewery, which he inherited from his father and subsequently sold. Robert Falcon Scott's early childhood years were spent in comfort, but some years later, when he was establishing his naval career, the family would suffer serious financial misfortune. In accordance with the family's tradition, Robert and his younger brother Archie were predestined for careers in the armed services. Robert spent 4 years at a local day school before being sent to Stubbington House School in Hampshire, a cramming establishment preparing candidates for the entrance examinations to the naval training ship HMS Britannia at Dartmouth. Having passed these exams, Scott began his naval career in 1881, as a cadet, aged only 13 years old. Early naval career Scott as a young man. In July 1883, Scott passed out of Britannia as a midshipman, 7th overall in a class of 26. By October, he was en route to South Africa to join HMS. Officers with a view to their undertaking polar exploration work in the future. He was impressed by Scott's intelligence, enthusiasm and charm, and the 18-year-old midshipman was duly noted. In March 1888, Scott passed his examinations for sub-lieutenant, with 4 first-class certificates out of 5. His career progressed smoothly, with service on various ships and promotion to lieutenant in 1889. In 1891, after a long spell in foreign waters, he applied for the 2-year torpedo training course on HMS. Offered explanations are missing from Admiralty records. In 1894, while serving as torpedo officer on the depot ship HMS. For early command and a chance to distinguish himself, rather than any predilection for polar exploration which motivated Scott, according to Crane, what passed between them on this occasion is not recorded, but a few days later, on the 11th of June, Scott appeared at the Markham residence and volunteered to lead the expedition. Discovery Expedition 1901-1904 Main article, Discovery Expedition. Discovery in 2005 at its home port of Dundee. The British National Antarctic Expedition, later known as the Discovery Expedition, was a joint enterprise of the RGS and the Royal Society, a long-cherished dream of Markham's. It required all of his skills and cunning to bring the expedition to fruition. Under naval command and largely staffed by naval personnel, Scott may not have been Markham's first choice as leader, but, having decided on him, the older man's support remained constant. There were committee battles over the scope of Scott's responsibilities, with the Royal Society pressing to put a scientist in charge of the expedition's program while Scott merely commanded the ship. Eventually, however, Markham's view prevailed. Scott was given overall command, and was promoted to the rank of commander before Discovery sailed for the Antarctic on 6 August 1901. King Edward VII, who showed a keen interest in the expedition, visited the Discovery the day before the ship left British shores in August 1901, and during the visit appointed Scott, a member of the Royal Victorian Order MVO, his personal gift experience of Antarctic or Arctic waters was almost entirely lacking within the 50-strong party, and there was very little special training in equipment or techniques before the ship set sail. Dogs were taken, as were skis, but the dogs succumbed to disease in the first season nevertheless. The dogs' performance impressed Scott, and, despite moral qualms, he implemented the principle of slaughtering dogs for dog food to increase their range during an early attempt at ice travel. A blizzard trapped expedition members in their tent, and their decision to leave it resulted in the death of George Vince, who slipped over a precipice on the 11th of March 1902. The Discovery Hut at Hut Point. The expedition had both scientific and exploration objectives. The latter included a long journey south, in the direction of the South Pole. This march, undertaken by Scott, Ernest Shackleton and Edward Wilson, took them to a latitude of 82 degrees. Zoological and geological findings. Some of the meteorological and magnetic readings, however, were later criticized as amateurish and inaccurate. At the end of the expedition, it took the combined efforts of two relief ships and the use of explosives to free Discovery from the ice. His insistence during the expedition on Royal Navy formalities had made for uneasy relations with the Merchant Navy contingent, many of whom departed for home with the first relief ship in March 1903. Second in command, Albert Armitage, a merchant officer, was offered the chance to go home on compassionate grounds, but chose to interpret the offer as a personal slight and refused. Armitage also promoted the idea that the decision to send Shackleton home on the relief ship arose from Scott's animosity rather than Shackleton's physical breakdown, although there were later tensions between Scott and Shackleton when their polar ambitions directly clashed. In public, mutual civilities were preserved. Scott joined in the official receptions that greeted Shackleton on his return in 1909 after the Nimrod expedition, and the two were exchanging polite letters about their respective ambitions in 1909-10 between expeditions. Ernest Shackleton, Scott, and Edward Wilson before their march to the South Pole during the Discovery Expedition, 2 November 1902. Scott pictured by Daniel A. Wehr Schmidt, 1905, National Portrait Gallery, London. Popular hero. Discovery returned to Britain in September 1904. The expedition had caught the public imagination, and Scott became a popular hero. He was awarded a cluster of honours and medals, including many from overseas, and was promoted to the rank of captain. He was invited to Balmoral Castle, where King Edward VII promoted him a commander of the Royal Victorian Order CVO. Scott's next few years were crowded. For more than a year he was occupied with public receptions, lectures, and the writing of the expedition record. The voyage of the Discovery in January 1906, he resumed his full-time naval career, first as an assistant director of naval intelligence at the Admiralty and, in August, as flag captain to Rear Admiral Sir George Egerton on HMS Antarctic Expedition. It was therefore unwelcome news to him that Ernest Shackleton had announced his own plans to travel to Discovery's old McMurdo Sound base and launch a bid for the South Pole from there. Scott claimed, in the first of a series of letters to Shackleton, that the area around McMurdo was his own field of work to which he had prior rights until he chose to give them up, and that Shackleton should therefore work from an entirely different area. In this, he was strongly supported by Discovery's former zoologist, Edward Wilson, who asserted that Scott's rights extended to the entire Ross Sea sector. This Shackleton refused to concede. Finally, to end the impasse, Shackleton agreed, in a letter to Scott dated 17 May 1907, to work to the east of the 170 degrees. Compares Scott's intransigence on this matter unfavorably with the generous attitudes of the Norwegian explorer Fridtjof Nansen, who gave freely of his advice and expertise to all, whether they were potential rivals or not. Marriage. Scott, who because of his Discovery fame had entered Edwardian society, first met Kathleen Bruce early in 1907 at a private luncheon party. She was a sculptress, socialite, and cosmopolitan who had studied under Auguste Rodin and whose circle included Isadora Duncan, Pablo Picasso, and Aleister Crowley. Her initial meeting with Scott was brief, but when they met again later that year, the mutual attraction was obvious. A stormy courtship followed. Scott was not her only suitor. His main rival was would-be novelist Gilbert Cannon, and his absences at sea did not assist his cause. However, Scott's persistence was rewarded, and, on 2 September 1908, at the Chapel Royal, Hampton Court Palace, the wedding took place. Their only child, Peter Markham Scott, born 14 September 1909, was to found the Worldwide Fund for Nature. WWF Terra Nova Expedition 1910-1912. Main article, Terra Nova Expedition. The routes to the South Pole taken by Scott Green and Amundsen Red, 1911-1912. Preparation. Shackleton returned from the Antarctic having narrowly failed to reach the pole, and this gave Scott the impetus to proceed with plans for his second Antarctic expedition on 24 March 1909. He had taken the Admiralty-based appointment of naval assistant to the Second Sea Lord, which placed him conveniently in London in December. He was released on half pay, to take up the full-time command of the British Antarctic Expedition 1910, to be known as the Terra Nova Expedition from its ship, Terra Nova. It was the expressed hope of the RGS that this expedition would be scientific primarily, with exploration and the pole as secondary objects, but, unlike the Discovery Expedition, neither they nor the Royal Society were in charge this time. In his expedition prospectus, Scott stated that its main objective was to reach the South Pole, and to secure for the British Empire the honour of this achievement. Scott had, as Markham observed, been bitten by the pole mania. In a memorandum of 1908, Scott presented his view that man hauling to the South Pole was impossible and that motor traction was needed. Snow vehicles did not yet exist, however, and so his engineer Reginald Skelton developed the idea of a caterpillar track for snow surfaces. In the middle of 1909, Scott realized that motors were unlikely to get him all the way to the pole, and decided additionally to take horses based on Shackleton's near success in attaining the pole, using ponies, and dogs and skis after consultation with Nansen. During trials of the motors in Norway in March 1910, man hauling would still be needed on the polar plateau, on the assumption that motors and animals could not ascend the crevassed Beardmore Glacier. Dog expert Cecil Mears was going to Siberia to select the dogs, and Scott ordered that, while he was there, he should deal with the purchase of Manchurian ponies. Mears was not an experienced horse dealer, and the ponies he chose proved mostly of poor quality, and ill-suited to prolonged Antarctic work. Meanwhile, Scott also recruited Bernard Day, from Shackleton's expedition, as his motor expert. First season Scott, writing his journal in the Cape Evans hut, winter 1911. On 15 June 1910, Scott's ship Terra Nova, an old converted whaler, set sail from Cardiff, South Wales. Scott meanwhile was fundraising in Britain and joined the ship later in South Africa, arriving in Melbourne, Australia in October 1910. Scott received a telegram from Amundsen stating, "Beg leave to inform you Fram proceeding Antarctic." Amundsen, possibly indicating that Scott faced a race to the pole. The expedition suffered a series of early misfortunes which hampered the first season's work and impaired preparations for the main polar march on its journey from New Zealand to the Antarctic. Terra Nova nearly sank in a storm and was then trapped in pack ice for 20. Increased, on 2 August, after the return of a three-man party from their winter journey to Cape Crozier, Scott wrote, "I feel sure we are as near perfection as experience can direct journey to the pole." Scott outlined his plans for the southern journey to the entire shore party, leaving open who would form the final polar team. According to their performance during the polar travel 11 days before Scott's team set off towards the pole, Scott gave the dog driver Mears the following written orders at Cape Evans dated 20 October 1911 to secure Scott's speedy return from the pole using dogs. "About the first week of February I should like you to start your third journey to the south, the object being to hasten the return of the third southern unit and give it a chance to catch the ship. The date of your departure must depend on news received from returning units, the extent of the depot of dog food you have been able to leave at one ton camp, the state of the dogs, etc. To take the two dog teams south in the event of Mears having to return home, as seemed likely, by 4 January 1912, the last two four-man groups had reached 87 degrees. January, declined sharply. A fall on 4 February had left Evans dull and incapable, and on 17 February, after another fall, he died near the glacier foot. Meanwhile, back at Cape Evans, the Terra Nova arrived at the beginning of February, and Atkinson decided to unload the supplies from the ship with his own men rather than set out south with the dogs to meet Scott as ordered. When Atkinson finally did leave south for the planned rendezvous with Scott, he encountered the scurvy-ridden Edward Teddy Evans, who needed urgent medical attention. Atkinson therefore tried to send the experienced navigator Wright south to meet Scott, but chief meteorologist Simpson declared he needed Wright for scientific work. Atkinson then decided to send the short-sighted Cherry Garrard on 25 February, who was not able to navigate, only as far as One Ton Depot, which is within sight of Mount Erebus, effectively cancelling Scott's orders for meeting him at latitude 82 or 8230 on 1 March on the return journey from the pole. Scott reached the 8230 degrees South meeting point for the dog teams, 3 days ahead of schedule, noting in his diary for 27 February 1912, "We are naturally always discussing possibility of meeting dogs, where and when, etc. It is a critical position we may find ourselves in safety at the next depot, but there is a horrid element of doubt." By the 10th of March the temperature had dropped unexpectedly to below minus 40. Jumble. With 400. Message to the public, primarily a vindication of the expedition's organization and conduct in which the party's failure is attributed to weather and other misfortunes, but ending on an inspirational note, with these words, "We took risks, we knew we took them, things have come out against us, and therefore we have no cause for complaint, but bow to the will of Providence, determined still to do our best to the last. Not to yield," and was erected as a permanent memorial on Observation Hill, overlooking Hut Point. A century of storms and snow have covered the cairn and tent, which are now encased in the Ross Ice Shelf as it inches towards the Ross Sea. In 2001 glaciologist Charles R. Bentley estimated that the tent with the bodies was under about 75. Their names will live forever. Oh England, land of the brave. 1915 statue of Scott at Portsmouth Historic Dockyard, sculpted by his widow, Kathleen Scott. The survivors of the expedition were suitably honored on their return, with polar medals and promotions for the naval personnel in place of the knighthood that might have been her husband's had he survived. Kathleen Scott was granted the rank and precedence of a widow of a knight commander of the Order of the Bath in 1922. She married Edward Hilton Young, later Lord Kennet, she becoming Lady Kennet, and remained a doughty defender of Scott's reputation until her death, aged 69. In 1947 an article in the Times, reporting on the glowing tributes paid to Scott in the New York Press, claimed that both Amundsen and Shackleton were to hear that such a disaster could overtake a well-organized expedition. On learning the details of Scott's death, Amundsen is reported as saying, "I would gladly forego any honor or money if thereby I could have saved Scott his terrible death." Scott was much the better wordsmith of the two, and the story that spread throughout the world was largely that told by him, with Amundsen's victory reduced in the eyes of many to an unsporting stratagem. The response to Scott's final plea on behalf of the dependents of the dead was enormous by the standards of the day. The Mansion House Scott Memorial Fund closed at £75,000, 2009 approximation £55. Expedition and the harsh Antarctic environment, but also includes critical scenes such as Scott regarding his broken-down motors and ruefully remembering Nansen's advice to take only dogs. Evans and Cherry Garrard were the only surviving expedition members to refuse participation in the film, but both republished their respective books in its wake in 1966. Reginald Pound, the first biographer given access to Scott's original sledging journal, revealed personal failings which cast a new light on Scott, although Pound continued to endorse his heroism, writing of a splendid sanity that would not be subdued. Another book critical of Scott, David Thompson's Scott's Men, was released in 1977. In Thompson's view, Scott was not a great man, at least, not until near the end. His planning is described as haphazard and flawed, his leadership characterized by lack of foresight, thus by the late 1970s. In Jones's words, Scott's complex personality had been revealed and his methods questioned. In 1979 came the first extreme attack on Scott, from Roland Huntford's dual biography Scott and Amundsen, in which Scott is depicted as a heroic bungler. Huntford's thesis had an immediate impact, becoming the contemporary orthodoxy after Huntford's book. Several other mostly negative books about Captain Scott were published. Francis Spufford, in a 1996 history not wholly antagonistic to Scott, refers to devastating evidence of bungling, concluding that Scott doomed his companions, then covered his tracks with rhetoric. Travel writer Paul Thoreau summarized Scott as confused and demoralized. What has happened to Scott's reputation, Crane argues, derives from the way the world has changed since the hopeless heroism and obscene waste of the First World War. At the time of Scott's death, people clutched at the proof he gave that the qualities that once made Britain great were not extinct, but with the knowledge what lay only 2 years ahead, the ideals of duty, self-sacrifice, discipline, patriotism and hierarchy associated with his tragedy take on a different and more sinister coloring. Crane's main achievement, according to Berchevsky, is the restoration of Scott's humanity, far more effectively than either Fiennes's stridency or Solomon's scientific data. Daily Telegraph columnist Jasper Rees, likening the changes in explorers' reputations to climatic variations, suggests that, in the current Antarctic weather report, Scott is enjoying his first spell in the sun for 25 years. The New York Times Book Review was more critical, pointing out Crane's support for Scott's account regarding the circumstances of the freeing of the Discovery from the pack ice, and concluded that, for all the many attractions of his book, David Crane offers no answers that convincingly exonerate Scott from a significant share of responsibility for his own demise. In 2012, Karen May published her discovery that Scott had issued written orders, before his march to the pole, for Mears to meet the returning party with dog teams, in contrast to Huntford's assertion in 1979 that Scott issued those vital instructions only as a casual oral order to Evans during the march to the pole. According to May, Huntford's scenario was pure invention based on an error. It has led a number of polar historians down a regrettable false trail. Scott's journals provide the basis for a book of blank verse sonnets by Kim Roberts, Fortune's Favor, Scott in Antarctica, Poetry Mutual, 2015. In 2016, Krzysztof Sienicki published Captain Scott, Icy Deceits and Untold Realities. In it, he gave a wide critique of scholarship on Scott, and concluded that Scott and his companions fabricated their misfortunes. References: Carrot, Four Things Captain Scott Found in Antarctica, BBC, accessed the 11th of October 2014. Carrot, ABC. Crane, P. Carrot. Crane, P. Carrot. Scott, P. Carrot. AB Preston, P. Carrot. Crane, P. Glacier. Carrot. Preston, P. Pole, I don't think they are very goody. Don't think he knows how bad an effect the monotony and the hard traveling surface of the barrier is to animals. Cited from Ranulf Fine's Captain Scott Hodder and Stoughton, London 2003, p. 219. F. Carrot Trygve Grand's diary. If we reach the pole, then Amundsen will reach the pole, and weeks earlier our prospects are thus not exactly promising. The only thing that can save Scott is if an accident happens to Amundsen. Cited from Ranulf Fine's Captain Scott Hodder and Stoughton, London 2003 p. 219. F. Carrot Huxley, Scott's Last Expedition, Volume 1, p. Carrot Huxley, Scott's Last Expedition, Volume 1, p. Near the End. Expedition, Volume 1, pp. Carrot. This honor did not entitle Kathleen Scott to call herself Lady Scott, although both Fines, p. Memorials. Carrot Captain Scott Memorial. Carrot ABC Jones, pp. Carrot Spufford, p.